Hello, everyone. My name is Serhii Plokhii. I am the director of the Ukrainian Research Institute here at Harvard University, and I welcome all of you to the next meeting of our seminar on Ukrainian studies. I don't know yet how many participants are there and where they're coming from, but I hope that with this particular event, we create really a global village. And I also hope that someone from the town of Sniatyn will be able to attend this event as well. It is my great pleasure to introduce our today's speaker, Dr. Matthias Kaltenbrunner, who is a visiting fellow at the Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute. Again, I am grateful to Matthias for being able, willing and able to actually postpone his research stay with us until this year. We unfortunately couldn't take any visitors last year. Matthias got his PhD in history from the University of Vienna in 2016. And since then has been a postdoctoral fellow at the Institute of East European History at the University of Vienna and at the Cool Folklore Center at the University of Alberta in Edmonton. His today's talk will be directly related to the project that he is working on here at Harvard Ukrainian Research Institute. The title of the project is The Globally Connected Village, a Ukrainian-Canadian History. And the book, I understand, is commissioned by and will be published by the University of Toronto Press. This is the second presentation here at Harvard that I'm attending Matthias's presentation. The first one was on his other book project dealing with a fascinating history of a person who experienced more than one political system and more than one system of camps and incarceration. But again, today's presentation will be dealing with the fascinating story of writing the history and documenting history of a place in Ukraine by someone living in the United States at the time of the Cold War without actually being able to access sources and maybe interview also people that he would like to interview. So I'm really looking forward to this presentation, and without further ado, I welcome Matthias, and Matthias, the floor is yours.
Thank you so much, Professor Plokhii, for this very nice introduction. I'm very glad and humbled to have the possibility to give this talk today. I also want to thank the faculty and staff at the Harvard Ukraine Research Institute for just their support during my stay. I also want to thank in particular Frank Sisson and Edward Kasinets for sharing their insights on Mykhailo Bazhans'kyi in particular. Just to start, Mykhailo Bazhans'kyi and the research I'm doing here at the Harvard Ukrainian Institute is part of my larger book project on what I call the globally connected village. So I will first say a few words about my concept, about my main ideas, then I will explain how Bazhans'kyi and his specific collection that is preserved here at Harvard fits into this picture. Okay, so one moment. So the globally connected village, I studied as case studies six villages in Sniatyn County in Western Ukraine. It was a part of Galicia, but located at the border to Bukovina. Today it's part of Ivano-Frankivsk Oblast or province. Initially, I wanted to focus only on one single village, but in order to have a little bit more sources, I made this kind of compromise and included several villages. At the moment, I'm working on an English version of my PhD thesis that has been published already in German. The reason why I took these villages in Sniatyn County as case studies was the Ukrainian writer Vasil Stefanik and his well-known novel, The Stone Cross. It's the first and I would say most important piece on migration in Ukrainian literature. It's about an elderly peasant who migrates to Canada. It's based on a true story. And here you see both a portrait of Vasil Stefanik, a lifelong inhabitant of Rusiv, of this village, and the stone cross that is preserved to date. I want to present you only very brief a timeline of migration processes that took part in these villages in Sniatyn County. As a rule, Ukrainian migration is divided into waves. In my research, I created some kind of alternative timeline, and I distinguished between the intentions, the original intentions of the migrants. So that in the very first phase of migration, we have to do it with intended permanent migration. That means homesteading in Canada on the prairies. And as early as 1903 or 1905, the nature of these migration processes changed, and people would go to Canada in order to work there for several years to save some money and to go back. Of course, very often the intended temporary migration turned into a permanent one, but this kind of temporary intention created different kinds of networks between the migrants and those who stayed behind in the villages. And then we have forced migration refugees that fled Western Ukraine during the Second World War. And you see here, in the case of Sniatyn, we don't have pre-World War II migration to the US. It was only after World War II that some of the refugees of the so-called displaced persons would end up also in the United States. My idea of the microhistory of the globally connected village was inspired by Peggy Leavitt, an American sociologist who wrote a remarkable book on migration from the Dominican Republic to the Boston area. And she called this kind of networks between migrants and those who stayed behind transnational villages. And I adopted this concept, made some adaptations, and came from transnational villages to globally connected villages or the globally connected village. What I try in theoretical and methodological terms is to somehow combine elements both of migration history and village history, or in other words, of global and micro history. So in other words, to investigate global connections on a micro level. And therefore, I consider villages not only as a physical place, but as a relational social space that is constituted constructed, you can also say if you want to, by networks of individuals, of migrants, and those who are staying behind, and I call them non-migrants. So both groups, migrants as well as non-migrants, are part of this social space of the globally connected village, and they are equally collaborating through the networks in maintaining this social space. What kind of networks I'm interested in? There are different kinds of communication practices that connect both migrants and non-migrants. The most basic form of communication is, of course, letters. Then we have the economic dimensions. We have remittances. Prior to World War II, it was primarily money that had been sent back. And after World War II, it was parcels with items of clothing that would be sold or at the black market in the Soviet Union. Then we have personal contacts, that is, physical contacts, that is tourism from the late 1950s onwards, after de-Stalinization, and even even visits of villages to Canada, and also to a much smaller degree to the US. I've got a few illustrations for you, so this kind of letters, invoices of parcels with items of clothing sent back to Soviet Ukraine, to the villages. Here I tried to measure somehow the degree of interconnectedness by scrutinizing a sample of 900 Canadian tourists, migrants who visited their native villages in the early 1960s. And it turned out, you see here, blue means intensive contacts, brown or gray means no contacts. And you see Sniatyn or Sniatyn County is one of the areas with a very high degree of global interconnectedness. Okay, so that's the globally connected villages. And now, how does Mykhailo Bazhans'kyi fit into this picture? Very brief on his life. He wasn't born in the village, he was born in the county center, Sniatyn, a small, typical Galician town with a very different population from the villages. So approximately one third of the population was Polish, one third was Jewish, and one third was Ukrainian. So Ukrainians were a minority in the town of Sniatyn, unlike in the villages that were almost entirely Ukrainian. Mykhailo Bazhans'kyi was an early exile from Galicia. He was sentenced by a Polish court in the late 1920s and went to Czechoslovakia. He was involved in the short-lived Kabardo-Ukrainian state in the late 1930s. During the war, he was imprisoned by the Germans, first in a Gestapo prison in Lviv, and then in a labor camp. He would later say that he's a concentration camp survivor, which is true insofar as the living conditions were very close to those in a concentration camp, but officially it was a labor camp run by the Gestapo, where he was imprisoned. And after spending some time as a DP in West Germany, he would immigrate to the US in 1949 and settle in Detroit. He passed away in 1994. I mean, he lived to the breakup of the Soviet Union, but he would never be able to travel back to Ukraine. Bazhans'kyi was a very prolific activist. He was involved in numerous Ukrainian organizations, both in Ukraine, Czechoslovakia, in Germany, and also in the US. He was, by his training, a journalist, and would in his later years become primarily, as I would say, an amateur historian. He was an extremely prolific book collector. I will come back to this. And he was first and foremost what I call here, I don't have a better term right now, probably you can help me. He was a Sniatyn networker. So he collected everything related to his native Sniatyn, to the town and the county, the villages around the town. And what is interesting here is that you see some kind of different networks. Initially, I talked about networks between migrants and non-migrants that create or construct the relational space of the globally connected village. In this particular case, it's networks between migrants. I mean, they have usually different functions, right? So networks between migrants, they help each other to with jobs, housing, and so on. That was not so much the case here. In this particular case, networks between migrants are focused on the native villages, on the native county, without having really direct access and without having the connections I was talking about before. And the result of these migrants to migrants networks and this Sniatyn networking is what I consider a globally connected, a microhistory of the globally connected village. Also, Bazhans'kyi probably wouldn't have framed it that way. And my own perspective is twofold, I would say, because on the one hand, I'm a consumer of his microhistory, so I use his sources in order to write my own microhistory of the Sniatyn villages. But on the other hand, I'm interested in the process of constructing this microhistory and this relational space, because it's exactly this kind of networks I'm interested in. And in this talk, I will focus on this process of doing globally connected, of doing global microhistory without having direct access to sources. What is extremely important in this context is the journal Sniatyn that came out in Detroit, Michigan from 1968 to 1976. It was edited by Mykhailo Bazhans'kyi in 14 volumes. He himself would say that his journal was an attempt to unite our countrymen like a family. A quote, Sniatyn is a symbol for the love we feel for our native town, for the school, the friends, for the organization, even for the nature, which is nowhere else in the world the way it is in Sniatyn. As we are far away, Sniatyn became even dearer, more beautiful to us, as it had been when we had had the opportunity to walk on this path, to touch the trees and plants, to listen to the singing of the birds on the Prut River, and to take a bath in the Prut's crystal clear water, to go for a walk at its sandy shores, to meet our friends, and to care for our dear community. Of course, there's a very strong nostalgia in this segment. I think Bazhans'kyi tried to compensate for the physical distance to his native Sniatyn by conjuring up the past. This fits into an overall tendency in the 1960s and 1970s when in North America, numerous migrants' committees published local histories enriched by personal reminiscences, which were as a rule dedicated to the county of origin in Galicia or elsewhere. But, and here's the main difference, Bazhans'kyi's vision went much further. As the subtitle of the journal said, in the face of the countrymen of the town of Sniatyn and its surroundings, it would not only be a journal, you know, where articles on local history would appear, but the journals should become a platform of interaction and networking for the migrants from Sniatyn country. So the question is again, what was the main point of reverence? Was it the town of Sniatyn? Was it the county of Sniatyn? Or were the villages in Sniatyn County? And I would say all of them, it was nothing that would exclude each other. The town was certainly important because Bazhans'kyi himself was a native of the town, because many people who contributed to the journal had attended school in Sniatyn. But at the same time, I would say contributors would primarily act as multipliers in order to attract fellow villagers. They would contribute particular articles on their native village, on the history of their own village. So I would say it was rather a kind of interplay of these different layers of local or also probably regional identity. And the target group of the journal was, despite of the universal claim to include all countrymen from the Sniatyn area, relatively narrow, because most of the contributors belong to the Ukrainian intelligentsia. They had some kind of secondary education. Some of them had also attended university. And the great majority of them had come to the US or Canada as refugees. So they also shared their common experience. Despite of the educational background, they also shared the common experience of being a refugee during or after World War II. A typical contributor of the journal was Yuri Stefanik, the youngest son of the writer Vasil Stefanik. He was both an interwar and post-World War II migrant. He went to Canada in the 1930s, came back to Ukraine only to come to Canada again as a refugee in 1948. And again, I think Yuri Stefanik is a very good example, because he would also invite other villagers from Rusiv to join the journal, some of whom were also related to him. One of him was his cousin, Mykhailo Stefanik of Regina, Saskatchewan, who had been an interwar migrant and who, like most interwar migrants in Canada from this particular area, was active in left-wing or pro-communist circles. So he was one, Mykhailo Stefanik was one of the very few from the large pro-communist community of Sniatyn migrants in Canada who would contribute to the journal. They were, in most cases, they were just, there was no contact. In addition to Yuri Stefanik, another very active contributor was the painter Ivan Kavan of Kalif village, who had also fled Western Ukraine in 1944. In almost every issue of the journal, the readers were offered a painstaking account on what the artist or his family members were doing at the moment. And Kavan endorsed emotively Bazhans'kyi's concept of the journal. The most important thing is that you have chosen, so quote, the most important thing is that you have chosen a really original approach and don't have imitated one of the many regional almanacs that are already existing in great numbers. I'm not against regionalism, just the contrary. I think that the smallest issue of the journal will be a valuable treasure for future historians who will use that issue and write an important work. When a single small stone falling from a mountaintop can even cause a terrible avalanche, from a single tiny issue can arise a great work. It can start with the fact that Taras Kablitsky has married off his son, and out of this can arise a great work, which value will surmount all our expectations. It's certainly not a coincidence that this wedding was mentioned, because it was precisely at this very wedding where many Sniatynites gathered and where Mykhailo Bazhans'kyi had the idea of founding, of establishing his journal. And what is interesting, I think, in this journal, there was a section called About the Lives of Our Countrymen. It was a kind of gossip section reporting news like whose kids married whom, or that Ivan Fortchuk from Tulova, who was living in Saskatoon, had moved to a retirement home in 1975, whereas his nephew had already attended his fifth sociology class at the University of Toronto, although he was working at the same time. Another issue of Bazhansky's networking activities was to honor donations. I mean, this was, of course, a very important aspect of Bazhansky's networking. As I heard, Bazhansky was living very modestly. He was living on social security checks later in his life. So he was really dependent on donations. And here you see, for instance, you have a list of donors. I mean, for those who are reading Ukrainian, you see sometimes in brackets, there is a K that means that the amount is in Canadian dollars, not in US dollars. And I also found among Bazhansky's papers, numerous lists of donors that he had to update all the time. So that was a very important part of his networking activities, of course. Another thing was as I said, most of the contributors were post-World War II migrants, but there were some exceptions. For instance, Dmitro Fortchuk from Tulova donated $100 on the occasion of the 40th anniversary of his mother's death to the Shevchenko Foundation in Winnipeg and was rewarded by having a 1912 photograph of his parental home published in the newspaper Vilnius Slovo. So you see, Bazhansky would also reprint everything what he would find on Sniatynites in other Ukrainian newspapers in North America and beyond. 2 years later, the same Dmitro Fortchuk donated another $100 on his mother's 100th birthday. So you see, in Fortchuk's case, these donations fulfilled clearly the function of commemorating deceased family members without having access to their graves. Bazhansky also published in his journal numerous letters of countrymen, preponderantly from Canada and the US, but also from South America, Great Britain, and the Federal Republic of Germany. One of these letters for instance, was written by Ivan Fortchuk, another Fortchuk from Tulova, who was already in his 80s. And the letter was partly printed in the journal, quote, "And I have written a lot on Tulova. I'm exchanging many letters with the old country. I had two brothers there, but they have already died. But there are many widows. We all belong to the siege. I was the deputy of the Koshuvi, that was a Cossack rank in the siege society. We are recalling the years when we were young, because now much has changed there, as you know. Tulova, Ustia, Kaliv, and Vidiniv had been dry villages." So he makes an allusion to the temperance brotherhoods. "Now they write that people are boozing. They are distilling horilka in their houses and drinking like a fish. They go to a wedding and everyone takes a firkin of horilka. A drunken grandson, bad to death, Grandma Marusik, he was 93 years old, and the culprit was jailed for 3 years for that." So you see here that some of the contributors had direct contact to Soviet Ukraine, and Bazhansky was eager to learn more about the living conditions there. And he would frequently publish letters from Ukraine. That was also in order to counter Soviet propaganda. He would, for instance, get Soviet Ukrainian newspapers or books and criticize them harshly. Or he would criticize other events that took place in Sniatyn. I give you only one example here. Bazhansky was upset by the fact that at the dancing event organized by the Oil and Gas Institute of Ivano-Frankivsk and the Sniatyn Institute of Cultural Education, a Moldavian as well as a Russian dance had been displayed. "That's how the Ukrainian culture is flourishing under Russian communist rule." Another important part of the journal were, of course, obituaries. And again, in some cases, the obituaries were dedicated to persons who had remained in the villages and and for instance, Ivan Kavan would write several obituaries on friends and acquaintances of him who had remained there in Soviet Ukraine. Bazhans'kyi would not only work on his journal, he would also organize congresses. There were two congresses of the so-called countrymen of the Sniatynites, one in Toronto in 1970 and the second in Detroit in 1976. And you see here an invitation to the second congress. You see, almost all of the materials I'm presenting to you are in Ukrainian, but that's just the way they are, because I think at least 90 or 95% of the materials of the Bazhans'kyi collections are in Ukrainian. So that was really his main language. And there are very, very few materials in English. What Bazhans'kyi also did, he went to Canada because as I said, most of the pre-World War II migration from the Sniatyn area was directed to Canada. And he went there to document the traces of the Sniatynites there. In 1976, he went to Alberta and photographed a cafe called Sniatyn, which is, as I learned now, moved to the Ukrainian heritage village. He would also visit a statue dedicated to Vasil Stefanik. I think he didn't go into detail here, but the statue was donated by the Soviet Union, which caused some kind of political conflicts among the Ukrainian community there. Bazhans'kyi would not work exclusively on Sniatyn. He was in general, as I said, a prolific book collector. And in 1974, he donated as much as 10,000 or probably even 12,000 Ukrainian books to Harvard. It was not initially, I think, and I'm also very grateful to Edward Kasinets, who gave me some insights. It was not initially intended, I think, to donate his book collection, but he just could no longer keep it in his house. So he donated it to Harvard. And later, after his passing, the rest of his personal collections, his papers, were also transferred to Harvard. I want to show you some of the materials I'm working with. I presented you now the journal, which is both, I would say at the same time, it was the result of his networking activities, but at the same time, it documented these very activities. So again, we have these two levels of source material, I would say. So it's both a source on the history of the villages in Sniatyn and town of Sniatyn, but at the same time, it documents the networks and Bazhans'kyi's activities. So here you see one of the boxes at the Harvard Ukraine Research Institute I was working with. And here you have several documents that would be typical for the way Bazhans'kyi practiced his microhistory. He would send numerous letters to everyone he could reach with any kind of connections to Sniatyn. He would send questionnaires in order to gather material on persons, on migrants from this region. Here we have, for instance, the Kuryluk family. Yaroslav Kuryluk was a veteran of the Polish-Ukrainian War of 1918-1919, was very active in the interwar period in establishing cooperatives in the village of Stetsva, next to Sniatyn. And here, for instance, he corresponded with his daughter. You also see, for instance, here, he collected every kind of material because Volodymyr Korolyuk was in 1980 the employee of the year in Great Falls, Montana. So he would also collect this kind of biographical material. And here you see on the right side, you see the reply letter by Mrs. Korolyuk, written in a very typical way. Every letter starts with "Glory to Jesus Christ, Slava Isusu Christu." So that was really the way Bazhans'kyi guarded his materials that he would later present in his journal. Again, he was, as I said, he was an avid collector of newspaper clippings. He would scour all kinds of Ukrainian newspapers, not only diaspora newspapers, but also Soviet Ukrainian newspapers that he had access to. And here, for instance, is an obituary of Semen Stefanik. That's the oldest son of the writer Vasil Stefanik and the brother of HURI Stefanik. And what is very interesting here, Semen Stefanik remained in Soviet Ukraine, and he made a remarkable career in the Soviet system. He even served as a deputy chairman of the Council of Ministers of the Ukrainian Soviet Republic in the 1950, and later he would be the director of the Ivan Franko Museum in Lviv. That's probably a typical feature because the Soviet regime always tried to somehow attract local intellectuals, and Semen Stefanik, who had been a lawyer in Interval View, was one of them. So here's an obituary of the Soviet newspapers. You see that the people subscribing here, the first one is Volodymyr Shcherbitsky, the first secretary of the Ukrainian Communist Party. And in the same folder on Semen Stefanik, I found some memorial notices of different diaspora newspapers of Svoboda, for instance. And what is quite astonishing here, or probably not astonishing, I don't know, that some people associated with the journal Sniatyn would make donations to the Harvard Ukrainian Studies Fund in order to commemorate Semen Stefanik and to show their sympathy for the grieving brother HURI. So, and I think that's probably a unique case when donations were made to the Harvard, to the Ukrainian Studies Fund at Harvard in order to commemorate a high-ranking Soviet official, right? Yes. Besides the journal, Mykhailo Bazhans'kyi established what he called the publishing house Sniatyn, the Vydavnitstvo Sniatyn in Detroit. And he published several books with his materials. I tried my best to translate the titles. I think they are very hard to translate. You see, they're very long. They are filled with nostalgia. But what is important here, I think his approach is remarkable in several respects. I think first it's remarkable because of the nature of information he collected. He collected literally every piece of information on Sniatyn County possible. So he would, for instance, in his last book here, The Dictionary of Biography, he would really include, simple peasants, some of whom had migrated to North America, some of whom had not. He would very often just, give the information that someone was a member of a particular church in Canada, that someone was living in a retirement home in Vancouver in the 1960s. He would also include in these books some non-Ukrainians. He would include some Jewish inhabitants of Sniatyn and also some Poles. In the second book here, Creative Dynamism of My Countrymen, he would not only somehow chronicle the organizational life of Sniatyn and the villages, but he would elaborate on every possible, every thinkable aspect of social economic life. He would, for instance, have lengthy articles on hairdressers in Sniatyn, for instance, and he would describe in great detail who was the hairdresser, how was the attitude towards Ukrainians. That was, of course, very important to him. He would do the same on tailors, on photographers, for instance, and he would describe in great details whether or not the photographers had stamps in or business cards in Ukrainian or only in Polish or in German. So it's just extremely rich. And I was constantly, when I was also in the first stage of my research, I was constantly drawing on these materials. What he also did in his publishing house Sniatyn, he reprinted some earlier books related to the area. Especially interesting is an ethnographic study of the Polish school inspector of Sniatyn, written in Polish in the 1890s. And Bazhans'kyi would translate it into Ukrainian because, of course, he was perfectly fluent in Polish. And he would reprint it in Detroit. Yes, and now what is, towards the end of my talk, I want to talk a little bit about how Bazhans'kyi's materials, his books, his journal, and also his concept of doing village or regional or local history migrated back to Sniatyn after the breakup of the Soviet Union. Instrumental in this respect was a distant relative of him, Julian Radevich. It was a retired teacher a retired teacher who would become interested in Bazhans'kyi immediately after the fall of the Soviet Union. In 1993, he was already in retirement age, he became a teacher at the re-established Ukrainian high school in Sniatyn, where he organized a club called Mykhailo Bazhans'kyi High School Brotherhood Bukutia. Bukutia is the region, is the historical name of the region around Sniatyn, but it also includes some parts of Kolomyia. The membership in this brotherhood wasn't limited to students and teachers, but also granted to numerous honorary persons with connections to Sniatyn, including, for instance, Fedya Bohrebennik, a Soviet-Ukrainian literary scholar and expert on Vasil Stefanik, who had been harshly criticized by Mykhailo Bazhans'kyi in his journal, right? Because he was Soviet-Ukrainian and had a completely different, would write things on Vasil Stefanik that Bazhans'kyi wouldn't agree with. Then what you see here, Julian Radevich also established a one-room museum on Mykhailo Bazhans'kyi in the city hall. You see here in the background with its landmark tower. And in 2008, he would initiate the construction of a statue of Mykhailo Bazhans'kyi at the square in Sniatyn. I mean, it was my impression, and I think I'm right, that you know, the style of the statue is very, very Soviet. It's still very rooted in socialist realism. But you see, it's dedicated to Bazhansky. Here you have another picture of the museum. There are some photographs of Bazhansky exhibited there. And what is also interesting, Radevich reprinted many of Bazhansky's articles and works in Sniatyn, and he also revived the journal Sniatyn. So right now there's still the journal Sniatyn functioning in Sniatyn, and they somehow draw the tradition from Bazhansky's Detroit journal. Okay, I think I have to come to the end. I think there are several things that we can learn from Bazhansky, from his research, from his approach. The first thing is that relational space, as I see it, can be created not only by networks between migrants and non-migrants, but also by networks between migrants. Here's the question, of course, what is most important in forming a person's identity and thus also the networks? Is it the village, the county, or probably the experiences? And I would say it's all three of them. The villages were instrumental because most people identified first and foremost with the village. Villagers migrated together. They would also stay together very often in the first years after the migration. And very often village networks and family networks were overlapping. And in Bazhansky's case, the village networks had the function of multiplying, of attracting new people who would collaborate with the journal, who would be interested in this kind of village history. The county was the larger framework, of course. I'm still not sure how much it really constituted an integral part of people's identity. I mean, I would say that the county is a kind of more amorphous unit. And it's not so clear where Bazhansky would really make how he would really differentiate. And then there's the experiences. I think it's extremely important in this context that most of the people who collaborated had the common experience of being refugees during and after World War II. And of course, with this experience came a very strong and staunch anti-Soviet outlook. Of course, there are also limits to Bazhansky's concept because as the history is based primarily on personal networks and of asking individuals, of inviting individuals to write about their villages, their personal experiences, the perspectives of the non-Ukrainian population is not represented, and the perspective of the large group of the pro-Soviet Sniatyn community in Canada is barely represented. Of course, what is probably most important, not only for students of migration or networks, as in my case, but for students of various subjects, of various topics here, is that the kind of sources Bazhansky collected and assembled wouldn't have been gathered under different circumstances. I think it's really this extreme lack of sources that prompted him to value every kind of information on Sniatyn, on everyday life, on social life, on economic life there. And I think it's exactly this kind of lack of sources and valuing of fragmentary information that makes his approach so modern, probably, right? Because thanks to this approach, which came out of necessity in his case, thanks to his approach, we can answer so many questions we are interested in now as researchers today, and that probably wouldn't have been deemed so important then. And certainly Bazhans'kyi's research precipitated the writing of village histories in Ukraine, in Sniatyn, precisely. And it precipitated not only the production, but it retransplanted, I would say, also a particular narrative, right? So it accelerated probably the transition from a Soviet historical narrative to a Ukrainian nationalist one. And it, at the same time, it also included the Ukrainian diaspora and all these networks. It included it or somehow transplanted it back into the villages and into Sniatyn. And most of the, or not most, but all of the village histories that emerged in recent years are to a very large degree based on Mykhailo Bazhans'kyi. So his impact is really, I think, hard to overestimate for regional and local history writing in this area. I think I have to come to an end. I thank you for your attention, and I will be very happy to answer your questions and to hear your critical comments and suggestions. Once again, thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Matthias. It was a very interesting presentation on a number of levels. And I, in particular, was thinking about this story of Bazhans'kyi also as a part of the bigger story of this mobilization within the Ukrainian diaspora around issues of history and culture that lead eventually to the creation of the chairs and the institute at Harvard. And in case of Bazhans'kyi, we have here a direct connection. So it's not just political mobilization, it's not just financial mobilization which was there, but it's also Harvard appears as the result of this broader interest in and attachment to Ukraine. The questions that I have, it's basically, they deal with the context of that particular story that you researched and uncovered for us. One part of that question is how unique was Bazhans'kyi? How many there were other people like that who were interested in their particular areas and regions? So was it an exception within the context of what was happening in Ukraine and diaspora or not? And the second part of that question is how unique he was for the history of Sniatyn. You mentioned that the majority of the population was not Ukrainian, that he, in his focus, really doesn't include much of non-Ukrainians. So were there Polish or Jewish projects in diaspora, again, outside of Ukraine at that time, that would be comparable to Bazhans'kyi, would compete with his project in any way? So again, it's about uniqueness of his undertaking and his life mission.
Thank you so much. Should I answer right now?
Sorry,
should I reply right now?
Yes, please. And again, we have a number of other questions that are coming from the Q&A here.
Yeah.
And I will be reading them, and also from YouTube. So again, those who joined us either on our platform or through YouTube, please send your questions. They will be discussed, they will be answered.
Thank you so much, Professor Plokhii. I think the interest wasn't unique at all. It was quite common, but the way Bazhans'kyi pursued his interest and the way he he practiced this history, I think that was rather unique because, as I said, there were some almanacs that would present the history of particular villages or the history of particular organizations, right? About Ridna Škola, Prosvita in a particular community. But I think what Bazhans'kyi did, he did publish not only the results, but he documented and published also the process. So in this particular case, we can really, we have insights into the process of knowledge production and how he maintained, created and maintained these networks. And I think it was for him an integral part to document this process. And I'm a little bit familiar with projects on Rohatyn County, which is also in Ivano-Frankivsk Oblast. But I never saw this level. I mean, there are some almanacs, but there's nothing beyond. So I think that the way he did it and the way he documented this is unique. The history of other similar projects, I only recently discovered that there was a Sniatyn Landmannschaft in New York City. And as far as I can say, this Landmannschaft was exclusively Jewish. So it would be interesting if there was any mention of Poles or Ukrainians, right? I haven't come across any kind of organizations of Polish Sniatynites. And my guess is that there weren't so many of them, at least not in North America.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much, Matthias. And we are turning now to the questions from the audience. And I start with a comment and then a question by Frank Sisson. And again, I know, Matthias, that you can read it in Q&A, but for those of us who don't have access to Q&A, I read it. So the comment, I see in the list of donors, Stepan Sidorchuk, a leading collector for the Ukrainian Studies Fund in Boston and a generous supporter of his family in Ukraine. And then the next comment slash question, the Canadian Ukrainians from this region in Sniatyn, were leaders of the communities, Svarich, the Kostashchuks, Kostash. The question is, to what degree is that portrayed in the journal? Also, how does the journal deal with the communist group? So this is the question.
Thank you so much. I mean, on Stepan Sidorchuk, Professor Sisi mentioned that he would both support the Ukrainian Studies Fund and support his family in Ukraine. And what I think is that there was sometimes a conflict of interest because Yuri Stefanik, for instance, who was an avid reader and contributor to the journal, he wouldn't really donate too much money. And I know that he was just sending an incredible number of parcels, not only to his close family, but also to his extended family in Rusiv, Sniatyn County. So I think that was certainly a conflict of interest in many cases. At the Kostashchuk, that probably I have to say that Svarich, Petro Svarich, was the most educated migrant from Sniatyn County that was among the early homesteaders in Canada. So he had high school education and he had been an officer in the Austrian army. I don't think that he himself was represented in the journal, but during his trip in 1976, Bazhans'kyi visited his sister, who was already in her 80s then and who was living in a retirement home in Edmonton, Alberta. The communist group, I think Bazhans'kyi was more concerned with battling or countering communist propaganda coming directly from Ukraine. And those contributors who belong to the so-called progressive camp, that is pro-Soviet camp in Canada, he rather wouldn't mention that they belong to this to the communist organizations, probably in order not to shame them. And that is only my guess now. I can't really corroborate this, but I think that he was probably afraid of the public image of Ukrainians in North America, and so he would be rather embarrassed of the fact that there was a number of Ukrainian communists from his native area in Canada.
Thank you very much for this comment. There is a question. Next question comes via YouTube from Margarita Balmaceda. Here is what she writes. During this period, Detroit as a city was undergoing very serious transformations, some of which affected European immigrant communities caught in the process of the so-called white flight. How do you interpret or assess that? Any marks left?
Yeah, to be honest, probably I myself, I mean, that's now, probably I myself a little bit a victim of the relational space, because I probably didn't pay as much attention as I could to the interaction of migrants with non-Ukrainians in North America, right? I was rather interested in the country, in their networks, to the native villages and among themselves. So I'm afraid I can't really say anything on Detroit. So far I'm not really familiar with the Ukrainian community there, because it was primarily Bazhans'kyi from Sniatyn who was living there, but who was a part of these much broader networks. And I just can't answer this question.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. The next question comes from Ivana Timchuk. And again, I understand that Mr. Chup comes from Sniatyn. So here is the question. Mr. Radavich was the principal at my high school, you have mentioned, and he truly was an enthusiast of educating people on works of Bazhans'kyi. As a student, I would study Mr. Bazhans'kyi's journals. I would love to be able to read them again. Are the journals available online?
I would say at least some of them are available online it's called diasporana.
And
I think most, but not all of Bazhans'kyi's works are available there. And they should be also available, I think, in the county library of Sniatyn, and in the Sniatyn, and in the Bazhans'kyi Museum in the city hall. And Julian Radavich, he even gave me some of the journals in original, because he gave me some original copies, because he had several copies of them there. So they should be there.
Thank you. Again, we are approaching our time, the end of our session. But again, if you still have any questions, please send them along. I will ask one more question, and this is about the way in which journal, at least, and maybe other materials in the collection integrate the history of Sniatyn into a broader space. And the question is, what are those broader spaces that the author is working with? Is it Galicia, Pokutia? Is it Western Ukraine of interwar period, or Ukraine as a whole? So where is Sniatyn located in this mental map that has been created by Mr. Bazhans'kyi?
Yeah, thank you for these questions, and I'm not sure if I can answer it. I would say Mykhailo Bazhans'kyi very much located Sniatyn within the broader, as he perceived it, the history as a struggle for independent Ukraine. And that was, I would say, his main focus. So he would include all kinds of other aspects, but probably his main focus was the struggle for independence in Ukraine. That was the reason why they had ended up in North America as refugees, unlike the migrants who had come to Canada prior to World War I or in the interwar time, right? So that was probably also the reason why they were represented only in a very limited way. But I would say Bazhans'kyi envisioned independent Ukraine in general. I'm not really sure if he had a separate Galician identity. Mm-hmm. So I think that he saw Sniatyn probably as a stronghold of the struggle for an independent Ukraine. That's what I think.
Mm-hmm. Okay, well, thank you very much. I'm looking at the Q&A and at chat functions. There are no other questions, and I would like to thank you once again for this very interesting presentation. There are many levels, and again, including the institutional history of Harvard Ukrainian community, the history of the Cold War. So I wish you all the best with your future research and certainly with your project. And I would also like to use this opportunity to invite our listeners or viewers, participants, both on Zoom and on YouTube, to the next event, to the next meeting of the Ukrainian seminars here at HURI. It will be on December 8th, and the topic is Information War in Donbass and Psychological Immunity Against Misinformation. The event is sponsored by the Temerty Contemporary Ukraine Program and will be moderated by Dr. Emily Chanel Justice. So I thank you again for joining us today, and happy Thanksgiving to those of you who are in the United States and celebrate that event. Thank you, and see you